Want to understand the hidden forces that drive global prices? Looking to build a career in finance or master risk management? Then understanding futures markets is essential. Welcome back to Derivatives and Risk Education. In lesson 3 of the Derivatives Foundations course, we're diving into the exciting world of futures markets. Let's begin with some background to set the stage. Futures markets are massive global marketplaces, trading trillions of dollars in value every day. Think of exchanges like the CME Group, that's the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, or the Intercontinental Exchange, ICE, or Eurex in Europe, B3 in Brazil, and exchanges in India, China, and Tokyo. These are just a few of the big players. So how does a futures contract come into existence? Let's take oil, specifically WTI crude, as an example. Imagine an airline in Dallas in October. They face jet fuel price risk for their February flight schedule. To manage this risk, the airline might buy crude oil futures contracts. At the same time, an oil producer in Midland, Texas, also faces oil price risk between October and February when they plan to sell their production. To manage its risk, the oil producer might sell crude oil futures contracts. Dallas Airline calls their energy broker and says, buy me 1,000 barrels of WTI crude oil for February delivery. The Midland oil producer calls their broker and says, sell 1,000 barrels of WTI crude oil for February delivery. Brokers enter these orders and the exchange's computer system matches them. A futures contract is created. The Dallas Airline is now long one February WTI crude oil futures contract. They've agreed to buy oil at a set price in February. The Midland oil producer is short. They've agreed to sell oil. Just like with many commodities, the airline probably doesn't want 1,000 barrels of crude oil physically delivered to Dallas, and the Midland producer isn't going to truck oil to the airline's hangar. They're using futures to manage price risk, so they will likely close out their positions. Delivery in oil futures is unusual for most participants, but the possibility of delivery is what connects the futures price to the spot price of crude oil in the physical market. We'll talk more about the pricing of futures and forward contracts in an upcoming lesson. Now that we have a basic understanding of futures markets, let's delve into the specifics of what defines a futures contract. When an exchange creates a new futures contract, they have to be incredibly precise about the terms. This ensures everyone trading the contract is on the same page. There are several key specifications that are standardized for each futures contract. First, there's the underlying asset. This is what the futures contract is based on. In our oil example, it's crude oil, specifically West Texas Intermediate, or WTI. But simply saying crude oil isn't always enough. Exchanges often need to define the exact grade or quality that can be delivered, especially for commodities where quality can vary. Think about agricultural products or even different types of metals. The exchange will specify acceptable quality levels. For some futures, a range of qualities might be deliverable, but the price is adjusted accordingly. Imagine a futures contract for coffee beans. The exchange might specify a standard grade of Arabica beans, but also allow delivery of a slightly higher or lower grade, with a predefined price adjustment to reflect the quality difference. Next is contract size. This is the standardized quantity of the underlying asset in one contract. It's a crucial decision. If the contract is too large, smaller traders might be excluded. If it's too small, trading costs per unit might become too high. The right size depends on the typical user. For some agricultural futures, one contract might represent a few truckloads of the commodity. To accommodate different traders, exchanges sometimes offer both standard and mini or micro contracts with varying contract sizes. Delivery arrangements are also critical. The exchange specifies where delivery can take place. This is very important for physical commodities due to transportation. For a futures contract on natural gas, for example, delivery might be specified at major pipeline hubs. If multiple delivery points are allowed, the exchange might adjust the futures price based on the delivery location, reflecting any transportation cost differences. Futures contracts are identified by their delivery months, like February crude oil futures or December gold futures. The exchange sets the exact delivery period within that month. Delivery months are chosen to align with production cycles or market needs. For example, agricultural futures often have delivery months around harvest times. At any point, contracts will be trading for the nearby delivery months and some further out months. The exchange also sets the start of trading for a new contract month and the last trading day, which is usually shortly before the delivery period begins. Price quotes are also standardized. For example, crude oil is quoted in dollars and cents per barrel. Financial futures might be quoted in index points or percentage points, depending on the asset. Finally, exchanges often set price limits and position limits. Price limits are daily caps on price movements. If a price hits the limit, is limit up or limit down, potentially causing temporary trading halts. These are meant to curb extreme volatility, though their value is debated. Position limits restrict the maximum number of contracts a single trader can hold to prevent market manipulation. These standardized specifications are what make futures contracts work effectively for hedging, speculation, and price discovery. Now, let's talk about margin accounts, a crucial mechanism for the smooth and safe operation of futures markets. To minimize risk of default, futures exchanges use a system built around margin accounts. Imagine a trader buys two February crude oil futures contracts. To participate, they must deposit funds into a margin account. You can think of this like a security deposit. The initial margin is the amount deposited when the contract is entered into. Let's say it's $5,000 per contract, so $10,000 total for the two contracts. Now, futures contracts use daily settlement or marking to market. At the end of each trading day, the margin account is adjusted to reflect the trader's daily gain or loss based on the change in the futures price. This daily adjustment is called variation margin. To ensure traders can cover potential losses, there's also a maintenance margin, a minimum balance you must maintain. Let's assume a maintenance margin of $4,000 per contract, or $8,000 total. If the balance falls below this, the broker issues a margin call, requiring the trader to deposit funds to restore the account to the initial margin level. Failure to meet a margin call can lead to the broker closing out the position. Conversely, if profits increase the balance above the initial margin, the trader can withdraw the excess. Let's illustrate this with a table showing a few trading days. We'll see examples of a margin call, a balance within the normal range, and a situation where the trader could withdraw funds. Let's look at this table to see how margin accounts work day by day. Remember, we're assuming our trader starts with two oil futures contracts, an initial margin of $10,000 and a maintenance margin of $8,000. On day one, we start with the initial margin of $10,000. Suppose the settlement price drops by $2.50 per barrel. For two contracts, that's a loss of $5,000. Ending margin balance falls to $5,000. Margin call, yes, because the balance of $5,000 is now below the maintenance margin of $8,000. The broker issues a margin call. The action required is to deposit $5,000 to bring the account back to the initial margin of $10,000. Day two, after meeting the margin call, the starting margin balance is back at $10,000. Now, let's say the price increases by $1 per barrel. That's a gain of $2,000. The ending margin balance rises to $12,000. Margin call, no. In fact, the balance is now above the initial margin. There's a potential withdrawal of $2,000. The trader could withdraw this excess or leave it in the account. On day three, the starting margin balance is $12,000. Let's say the price decreases by $1.50 per barrel. That's a loss of $3,000. So the ending margin balance becomes $9,000. Margin call, no. The balance is below the initial margin, but above the maintenance margin. No action is required, and the account continues to operate normally. As you can see from this example, the margin account balance fluctuates daily with price changes. The minimum initial and maintenance margin levels are set by the futures exchanges themselves, and they are designed to reflect the price volatility of the underlying asset. More volatile assets will typically have higher margin requirements. Importantly, margin requirements are the same whether you're long or short a futures contract. This symmetry is a key feature of futures markets, making it just as straightforward to bet on prices going down as going up. Behind the scenes, all of this margin processing is managed by a clearinghouse. The clearinghouse acts as an intermediary to every futures trade, becoming the buyer to every seller and the seller to every buyer. This means the clearinghouse guarantees that all trades will be honored, significantly reducing credit risk in the market. The margin system is really the backbone of futures markets. It might seem complex at first, but it's designed to protect both buyers and sellers and ensure the financial integrity of the market. It's a system that has been tested through many market crises and has proven to be remarkably robust. And that brings us to the end of part one of our lesson on futures markets. Today we've laid the foundation by understanding what futures markets are, how futures contracts are specified, and crucially, how margin accounts operate to ensure the smooth functioning and financial integrity of these markets. In our next lesson, we'll continue our exploration of futures markets by looking at market quotes, delivery processes, different types of traders and order types. If you found this lesson helpful, please give it a like and subscribe to the channel for more videos on derivatives and risk management. See you in the next video.